Okay. Welcome to Patchwork Worship on this almost end of August day. Welcome to those who are gathered here. Hello, everybody. And those who are watching either now remotely or at some point in the future when you log on and take a look. We'll be sharing communion today, and so if you are remote from us and wish to participate, you might want to think about what kind of elements, crackers, bread, juice, wine, whatever you have, so that at that point in the service, you can join us wherever you are. Also, we will not be singing tonight because of COVID restrictions. And I will stay away from people and not wear a mask until we do distribution. So, and then I will wear a mask and my gloves. I'll be good. So, all right. So, we'll be talking about traditions and traditionalism tonight, and so actually one of our traditions is that we go around, gather ourselves into community by sharing our name. I'm Karen.
I'm Susan.
Laura.
Amy.
Charlie.
Jane.
Bill. Jane. Here comes Jane. Okay. Thank you. Celebrations, I saw on the calendar, Bill Hemminger's birthday is tomorrow. That should be a big round one for him, I think. Like 70, maybe? You didn't hear it from me. Well, I think he's about my age, so, okay. Okay, whatever. It's Bill Hemminger's birthday tomorrow, and so we wish him a happy birthday. Are there other events or birthdays to share that we're aware of? Okay. So, tradition and traditionalism. I have run across people who say, it's not true if it's coming from somebody else, if it's tradition, that's not authentic. And I beg to differ, but I'll have some words both from the lessons for today's lectionary from James and from Mark. So they have said that the seven last words of the church is we never did it that way before. My mother has this wonderful sweatshirt. On the back it says, ponder anew what the Almighty can do. I want that sweatshirt. So, we never did it that way before. Are there other names checking in? Oh, here. Okay. Jean and Helen are checking in. John Rich is here and says hi. Randy is present. And I think those are the ones that have written in the chat. And I don't see any other celebrations or birthdays listed there, so. I want to share a reading from James, the first chapter. Every generous act of giving, with every perfect gift, is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. In fulfillment of his own purposes, he gave us birth by the word of truth, so that we would become a kind of first fruits of his creatures. You must understand this, my beloved. Let everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger, for your anger does not produce God's righteousness. Therefore, rid yourselves of all sordidness and rank growth of wickedness, and welcome with meekness the implanted word that has power to save your souls. But be doers of the word, and not merely hearers who deceive themselves. For if anyone are hearers of the word and not doers, they are like those who look at themselves in a mirror, and on going away, immediately forget what they were like. But those who look into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and persevere, being not hearers who forget, but doers who act, they will be blessed in their doing. If any think they are religious and do not bridle their tongues, but deceive their hearts, their religion is worthless. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God is this: to care for orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself unstained by the world. That's far that first reading. James is called a very practical epistle. He is concerned about what people do with what they believe. And this is a passage that shows that. A reading from Mark chapter 7. Jesus is having an encounter with the Pharisees and some of the scribes. And they were not there in a friendly way. Let's put it that way. Now, when the Pharisees and some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus, they noticed that some of the disciples were eating with defiled hands, that is, without washing them. They had not gotten the word on COVID, I guess. For the Pharisees, this in parentheses, for the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they thoroughly wash their hands, thus observing the tradition of the elders. And they do not eat anything from the market unless they wash it. And there are many, also other many traditions that they observe, the washing of cups and pots and bronze kettles. End of parentheses. So the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not live according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" And Jesus said to them, "Isaiah prophesied rightly about you, hypocrites. As it is written, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines. You abandon the commandment of God and hold to human tradition.'" Then he called the crowd again and said to them, "Listen to me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside a person that by going in can defile, but the things that come out are what defile. For it is from within, from the human heart, that evil intentions come. Fornication, theft, murder, adultery, avarice, wickedness, deceit, licentiousness, envy, slander, pride, folly. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person." Same crew. So, tradition. There's an ancient story of a sentry who was standing day after day at this one particular spot with no apparent reason for being there. So one day a passerby came by and asked him why he was standing there in that particular spot. And he replied, "I don't know. I'm just obeying orders." And so then the passerby went to the captain and asked him why the sentry was posted there at that particular spot. "I don't know," the captain replied. "We're just following orders." So this prompted the captain of the guard to pose the question to a higher authority. "Why do we post a sentry on that particular spot?" he asked the king. But the king didn't know. So he summoned his wise men and he asked them the question. The answer came back that 100 years before, Catherine the Great had planted a rose bush and had ordered a sentry placed there to protect it. Well, the rose bush had been dead for 80 years, but the sentry still stood guard. The tradition had been passed along, but the meaning was completely gone. The Pharisees who criticized Jesus had carefully studied all God's rules, and Jesus and his disciples, they know, are breaking them, going against tradition openly, no apologies. Why do your disciples not wash their hands? They're going against the tradition, don't you know? But Jesus does not mess around at that point. He has a harsh answer for them. "You are hypocrites. You're just doing lip service. It's just for show. Your heart isn't in it." Well, it can be easy to find ourselves in a position where what we're saying doesn't match what we're doing. When my sister Barb was confirmed, her sponsors came to visit. Now, they had 5 boys, including the youngest, who are twins. All 5 made it to adulthood safely. We were surprised at that, but anyway. Gene, the dad, was quite the photographer, and he had his easel, he had his stand set up and his little thingy that told the camera when to shoot. And then he ran over and joined the rest of us lined up by the piano for the official shot. And one shot after another, the twins took turns making weird faces. Finally, he had had enough. He grabbed the little one closest to him and he shook him a little and he said, "You are gonna look happy and you are gonna smile or I am gonna paddle your little behind." Well, that was the end of the picture taking, as the rest of us tried unsuccessfully to stifle our laughter. It's kind of tough. So Jesus says, don't bother just fixing up what shows up on the outside, because it's what's inside where faithful heart are, faithful living starts. It's an inside job, if you will. Not lip service that honors God, but service from the heart. There are some that want to say that anything we do that's been passed down is dead. Not from the heart, an exercise in empty ritual. But Lutheran historian with this wonderful name, Yaroslav Pelikan, with a K, has said, "Tradition is the living faith of those now dead. Traditionalism is the dead faith of those now living." And he said, traditionalism is what gives tradition a bad name. Traditions can serve God, or traditions can stubbornly stand in the way of doing God's work. An example. During a service at an old synagogue in Eastern Europe, when the Shema, it's part of their liturgy, their creed, when that prayer was said, half the congregants stood up and the other half remained seated. And the half that was seated started yelling at those standing to sit down, and the ones standing yelled at the ones who were seated to stand up. So the rabbi, learned as he was in the law and the commentaries, really just didn't know what to do. His congregation suggested that he consult a housebound 98-year-old man who was one of the original founders of the temple. The rabbi hoped that the elderly man would be able to tell him what the actual temple ritual tradition was. So he went to the nursing home with a representative of each faction of the congregation. The one whose followers stood during the Shema asked the old man, "Is the tradition to stand during this prayer?" And the old man answered, "Nope, that is not the tradition." And then the one whose followers sat said, "Then the tradition is to sit during the Shema." And the old man said, "No, that is not the tradition." And then the rabbi said to the old man, "But the congregants fight all the time, yelling at each other about whether they should sit or stand." And the old man interrupted, exclaiming, "That is the tradition." Too often it's the wrong thing that gets passed down from generation to generation. So how do we distinguish between a life-sustaining tradition passed on down through the generations and the empty external show of traditionalism? So we need to take the advice drawn from that reading from James today. Look in the mirror. Look in the spiritual mirror. Does it register for us what is truly there that we see, or do we miss it? Not only has Jesus' detractors missed seeing the truth about others, Jesus says, they haven't really seen themselves either. They might look squeaky clean on the outside, but the inner truth is different. Wearing the glasses of self-righteousness makes folks see themselves in a better light than they should, and others in a worse light than they could. And this is spiritually deadly, because this kind of a skewed view in the mirror misses the things that really spoil and distort God's image. Evil intentions, things they do or fail to do that hurt others, the ways that they make others' lives a burden. They miss seeing the good in those they've condemned in God's name. But when we wear the glasses of God's love, we can begin to see ourselves and others as God created us to be. To see ourselves with all of our own unique faults and flaws, with all of our own unique gifts and talents. To see ourselves simply as beloved, forgiven children of God, wearing the Jesus glasses of love in action, we're better able to see others in that same light. What difference will what we see make in what we do with the gift of our lives? Living out our faith from the heart means we need to respond to what we see, to be hearers and doers. Don't just take it in. Don't just talk about it. Do something. God's looking for the heart of mercy beating within whatever body of tradition we pass along. God's goodness and grace comes to us hidden in the ordinariness of our lives, the ordinary struggles and joys that we face. It's there. Look. May God's Spirit always guide our hearts to God's heart so we can share that faithful and loving service in everything that we do. I can tell you've heard some of these stories before. They're good. They're good. Okay. All right. So, we have Chris Davis who has joined us. Are there prayer concerns and we can share them with our group that's here, or you can put them in the chat and we'll respond. I have some from what Amy shared earlier this week. So we conclude our yes.
I'd like to keep in our prayers Brittany Westbrook, who has had some surgery and has been a tough go. That we took her back to her surgeon the other day.
Mm.
But I think all the prayers work because I think she's going to be okay.
Okay, for Brittany. For Brittany.
I'd like to have her return to somehow that she doesn't have it.
Okay. For Darlene, health issues. We're glad that you're here with us tonight. That's great. And of course, we've been praying for Nelia, and it was good news with her tests. She didn't need them to rearrange her heart in any way at all. So she got a good heart. We knew that. So let us pray for Darlene and for Brittany. We pray for Ruth and her family, a close friend of Jane Vickers. She's on a vent and has COVID and other things that are really a challenge for her. So prayers for Jane and also for Ruth as she deals with this turn of events with her friend. All these people we bring to you and pray for your healing. Gracious God, hear our prayer. We pray for the families and communities of those killed in Afghanistan and all those in peril seeking to find safety, and those who are working hard to make that happen. And we pray for this country that we could come together to weather the difficult transition at this time coming out of this war. Gracious God. We pray for those affected by Hurricane Ida. They say the strongest since 1850, coming ashore on this 16th anniversary of Hurricane Katrina. So we pray for folks in Louisiana, in Mississippi, and all the places that this big monster storm will affect. And we pray for policies that will help with the planet so that these storms do not just get worse. Gracious God. We continue our prayers for Tom North's family. They mourn the death of Tom's nephew, Teague, in a car accident. He was particularly close to his nephew, and that's really hard, hard. We pray, gracious God, hear our prayer. Guide and assist those in the parts of the world that are struggling to get people quickly and efficiently vaccinated. We pray for all the people to act in ways that are wise and that care for the neighbor as we continue to face escalating and at times overwhelming COVID threat. Gracious God. We pray especially for medical caregivers, other essential workers, educators, administrators, people without access to resources, people of color, people who are homeless, people in congregate settings, and people with disabilities, that they may be honored and receive the honoring that they need in their daily lives. Gracious God. We pray for our country and leaders that they might lead us with wisdom, courage, and compassion. We pray to drive out those demons of prejudice and hatred and violence and bring justice for the poor and those at the margins. Free us all from fear. Inspire cooperation so people can find true hope. Show us ways to overturn untruths that distort our common life. Gracious God, we pray for our undocumented neighbors and their families, that they might find resources, hope, justice, and compassion to make a way forward. We pray for families out of work and out of options, for renters who can't pay and small landlords who can't go on without the rent payments. Gracious God, hear our prayer. Yes, Chris is asking for prayers for Darlene. And yes, gracious God, hear our prayer. Are there other prayers? We offer all these prayers to you, God, because you have promised to be with us, to hear us, and to walk with us in our lives. Okay, so we have time for joys. Are there some joys that people have to share? I mean, the good news with Nelia, that's a joy. Okay. Bill and Gail and their son healed your jammed printer. That's good. That's a joy. Yeah.
I would like to add on to that joy.
Okay.
It was really our son John who was the hero of the situation. And it was a joy for me to see him so wonderfully and graciously step in.
Mm-hmm. So your son, John, was the true hero, but you were proud mama seeing what a good job you had done on raising this. Yeah, okay. You take all the credit for that, okay.
Our daughter, after she turned 18, assured me that we had done a relatively good job of raising her. And from there on, anything that she did, right or wrong, was on her.
Okay. Did that work? Yeah. So nothing like having an 18-year-old saying you did a relatively good job of raising me. Yeah. Well. Yeah. That's true. That's true. Other joys. I heard about a survey that was given to, teenage type age. And while they are saying that right now they are living through hard times, the survey said that 90% of them were optimistic that their future would be all right and good and better than now. And I mean, even if you take into consideration, young people's idealism and, the wish to show that their parents' generation didn't get it right, well, it's true, but I found that heartening to the point perhaps even of being a joy. Let's see. No other joys listed there. Okay, another joy is there's a book published. Yes, Bill Heminger is the editor and a contributor too, and Amy has written a chapter about patchwork in this book, and the plug, Growing Good, available through Amazon or IU Press?
I guess, yeah.
That's what they're saying. Yeah. Well, congratulations. That's a good thing. Other joys? Okay. Now, according to our tradition, it's time to lift up our gifts. Some of them will go here in this lovely bowl to contribute to the work of Patchwork. And some of the gifts don't fit in the bowl. Do we have some of those that we want to name? Yeah. So, in the background, no more.
Yeah.
All right. A niece who showed up. I had my sister looked at the video from my church last week, and she really heartened me. She said, "Nice job, Karen," in the comments on the church's Facebook page. So, I was happy. Just to get that encouragement, you know? That was good. Other joys?
Yeah, I think right along with that, you are a joy to all of us, and probably not said enough how much we appreciate your service.
Oh.
How much we
thank you.
What you contribute.
Oh, thank you. Will you feed me at the potluck tonight? Thanks. Thanks for that. Good word. I really feel like you guys are kind of like my tribe, you know? So it's good to be able to share. Okay. Yeah, here I put it. For all the gifts, the ones that are here and the ones that are here and out there, we give thanks to God. Okay, Natasha says she's here. All right. So, I am going to put on gloves. The last time I had gloves available to me, I put the sanitizer on, and then I tried to put the gloves on, and it really did not work. It didn't work a bit. So I got smarter about these things. If I get smart enough to put one finger in each hole. Our distribution for communion tonight will be, I will break off and drop a piece of bread into your hand as you come by here. And on the silver tray, the glasses have at least some wine in each glass. Darker tray are grape juice. So one of our traditions when we gather is to do this, passed down from generation to generation, this gathering, this sharing, this remembering, this meal, this traditional meal. And Jesus said, I want you to hand this down from generation to generation. And when you do it, I want you to remember what I have done for you. And that in this sharing, I am here with you. And so when we gather, we remember that Jesus, with his followers on the night in which he was betrayed, took the bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and he said, take this and eat it. This is my life broken as this loaf is broken for you. Remember me when you gather. And he took the cup. And he blessed it, and he gave it for them to share. And he said, drink of this. This cup is my life poured out for you, for forgiveness, for welcome, for wholeness, for hope. Do this and remember me. And so we gather and remember and celebrate and share. Come, the meal is ready. Body of Christ broken for you. This is the body of Christ broken for you. Or the body of Christ broken for you. Amy, this is the body of Christ broken for you. Gail, the body of Christ broken for you. Bill, the body of Christ broken for you. Yes, the body of Christ broken for you. Darlene, the body of Christ broken for you. Jane, the body of Christ broken for you. So, we share. Thank you for the bread. Yeah, it's always just so good and beautiful. I mean, not always do you get that when you do communion, but it's good. If we were singing, we would be singing right now, but we're not, so we're not. So announcements, Thursday potlucks at Sean's, they're suspended until further notice because of COVID. And so the plan is to continue with these hybrid in-person and online Sunday services, and you know, we're all fully vaccinated, and we'll continue to do CDC guidance here. So there are going to continue to be potlucks offered for those who wish to participate. Food is good. Also, we have someone signed up, Jane and Nils. Maybe you're just Jane, going to do the service next week?
Jane and John.
Jane and John. Okay, thank you.
John's doing communion.
John's, okay. And I am providing music that people don't sing to. Okay. All right. But there are some other dates that need filling in, and so you can check with the office or with Darlene or stop by and take a look sometime. Are there other announcements to share?
So there's First Friday, this Friday, between 5:30 and 9. We'll have most everything happening outdoors, like we've been. The Washington Avenue will be closed right in front of Patchwork, like it's been. Food trucks. We have two musical groups. Drum for Enlightenment will be here from 5:30 to 6:30, and then, and I'm totally blanking, you can look at Patchwork's Facebook page, and then the main, and then the, there'll be a different group from 5:30 to, or 6:30 to 9.
Okay. So, big First Friday coming up this Friday.
And if you don't have your fill of music that night, then the following night, which is Friday or Saturday, is Front Porch Fest, where there's musicians on front porches all throughout this neighborhood. And so this year there'll be musicians in Patchwork's Tower, and I think it's from 5:30 to 8, but...
Okay.
You can get more information.
Okay. Front Porch Fest, Evansville, on Saturday for music, and First Friday on Friday for two different groups. And check the Patchwork webpage.
Facebook page.
Check some. Other announcements to share. Okay. Then let the people say amen. Nice timing.